This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA.
Numbskulls, I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Everybody, welcome to another edition of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA Radio, the memory-making station. Big John here with you, along with my ever-present sidekick and co-host, Steve Archiver Bannock. Hello there.
Howdy do.
And we've got roughly another 55 minutes of old-time radio enjoyment for you.
That we do.
And we've got some programming by request this time around.
Ooh.
And yes.
Fun.
Uh-huh. And we got a little bit of mail we're going to catch up on, too, hopefully time permitting. But right off, I think we're going to get into our first program. And that is going to be something that I haven't told Steve about yet, so he can't tell you what it is.
I know, I'm at a loss for words here.
Yes, this is what you call preparation, folks. There's a preparation H joke in there somewhere, but I'm not going to use it. The first program we have up for you by request is a Bickerson's program. Actually, this is one of the full-length ones when they were on a program called Dreamtime. And this is from February the 23rd, 1947. Of course, Don Ameche, Francis Langford as the Bickersons in a couple of sketches there. Francis, I believe, croons a tune for us.
Boo. Not like that.
Thank you, Crosbingy. Danny Thomas in there as brother Amos, Blanche's brother Amos, causing his usual amount of grief for John Bickerson. And if you'll pardon a little bit of nasal quality in my voice, I've just got a bit of the flu bug here that I'm trying to fight off.
And here I'm the one who had the nasal surgery.
Well, you've had all kinds of stuff jabbed into you lately. You had some other sorts of
tests. I also had a nerve block done.
Yeah.
People said I was full of nerve.
Well, we all know you have quite a bit of nerve, Steve, so...
Yeah.
I gotta get a rimshot sound effect here for our bad jokes. It's
how's
gotta
that?
Be on disc, of course, otherwise we'd wear a tape out of that. You see, we would use it so much.
Yes, my cheap jokes, I mean, it would just wear itself out.
I
say those all the time. That's all you get from me. You don't
maybe
get any other
just,
kind.
Maybe just like a 55-minute episode of The Glowing Dial, nothing but rimshots over and over and over again.
That would be different.
I think some people would prefer that, actually, but...
Send us your mail and tell us whether you'd like that or not.
Okay. Snail mail, email, stay tuned, because toward the end of the program, a good friend of ours, Fred Foy, is going to tell you how to get in touch with The Glowing Dial, so stay tuned for that. But further, I practice these things, so I don't make any slip-ups, like the ones you just heard. Steve, if you would reach for our good friend, the McGee Machine, we're going to tune in this first program here.
All right. I'm
okay.
Over here.
All righty. And he has clickety-clicked it into place. And it's warmed up. Actually, I pre-warmed it up, actually, so it wouldn't take so much time. But anyway, close your eyes, sit back, and remember, Dream Time, featuring the Bickersons from February 23rd, 1947.
It's Dream Time. Ladies and gentlemen, the makers of Dream Shampoo are pleased to present the 11th in a series of new programs written by Phil Rapp, produced by Carlton Alsop, and starring Don Ameche.
Blanche, why don't you let me sleep, huh?
Danny Thomas and Francis Langford, who sing...
Somebody loves me, I wonder who, he can be. Somebody loves me, I wish I knew, who can he be, worries me. For every boy who passes me, I shout, hey, maybe, you were meant to be my loving babe. Somebody loves me, I wonder who, maybe you. Somebody loves me, I wish I knew, who can it be, where is me? For every boy who passes me, I shout, hey, maybe you were meant to be my loving baby. Somebody loves me, I wonder who, baby. Maybe, maybe do.
Not 50%, not 75%, but 100%. Yes, it's 100% true. Dream Shampoo reveals all the sparkle, all the sheen, all the dazzling brilliance of your hair. Never before, Dream, could any shampoo leave your hair so lustrous. Now, that's because Dream is not a soap shampoo. It never leaves dingy, dulling film on hair to hide its natural beauty. And what's more, Dream does not dry out your hair. Instead, its fragrant, freshening whipped cream lather leaves your hair sublimely smooth, beautifully behaved, easier to set, easier to curl, easier to arrange. And Dream removes unsightly dandruff the first time you use it. So for lovely, lustrous hair, for all types of hair, dry, normal, or oily, Dream Shampoo with Hair Conditioning Action. Use it at home or ask for it at your beauty shop. Buy it at all drug, department, or 10-cent stores, in the blue and yellow package. Remember, never before Dream could any shampoo leave your hair so lustrous, yet so easy to manage. Yes, your hair can have that dazzling sheen the very first time that you use Dream. And now here is your host for the evening, Don Ameche.
To make mention of the fact that we received a great many letters from listeners, most of which were very encouraging. However, there is one letter that calls for an answer from Danny Thomas.
Call and I shall answer, Don.
Hello, Danny.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you. What's the gist of the note, Don?
Well, it's just this. The writer, a lady of middle age, I should guess, suggests that you sing a serious song now and then.
Well, her suggestions may be well meant, Don, but serious songs are for serious singers.
No question about it.
A man has to be trained in the art of delivering a ballad.
No question about it.
And I'm a comedian. I said I'm a comedian. Seems to be a question about it.
No, no, not in my mind, Danny. But this lady has an idea that you shouldn't be facetious all the time. She thinks jokes are cheap.
She does, huh? Wait till she has to buy a few.
At any rate, the letter is very complimentary, and she goes so far as to compare you with Al Jolson, possibly the greatest entertainer of all time.
No question about that.
She wants to know why you don't sing the kind of songs he did.
Well, you just don't write tunes like that today. Besides, Jolson had a wonderful gimmick.
Gimmick?
Weenie. Squeeze. That's a songwriter's jargon for trick.
Oh.
Look,
oh.
He sang about his mother, his kid sonny boy, and his home in Alabama all in one season. That's pretty powerful stuff, kid.
That's quite a gimmick.
I mean, what have we got to sing about? You know we can't sing about mother. We'd be called corny. After all, you got to remember, this is the atomic age. Oh, we're a sharp, brilliant people. I mean, we're so much more brilliant than our forebears, we now know how to destroy ourselves 50 times as quickly.
Yeah, you have a point, Danny.
So what can we sing about and be up to date? Schizophrenia? Or maybe kleptomania. Can you imagine singing a song called "A Pretty Kleptomaniac Is Like a Schizophreniac, But the Malady Lingers On"?
I never heard of that one.
Well, maybe you'd like me to sing about that new medical discovery, sulfahyathiaparapenicillamide. What a medicine that is, brother.
Great, huh?
Great. They haven't found a disease for it yet. But there is one subject that is abreast of the times and still has a great depth. Archaeology. Or is it archaeology?
Well, I wouldn't know. Are you qualified to sing about the study of lost races?
I haven't had a winner all season. Don, would it shock you if I told you I took a special course in archaeology at Cairo Prep?
No.
Yes, sir. I'm a graduate archaeologist. Or is it Archie?
Why don't you call Duffy's Tavern?
I'll do that. Now, as soon as I received my diploma, the entire graduating class was sent to the Egyptian desert to search for relics. Mm. The second day out, I unearthed a priceless old vase. Or is it vase?
Either is correct.
Or is it either? Well, the third day while I was snooping, that's right, snooping, around the pyramid, I found an unopened crypt.
A crypt?
Crypt. It was full of ossified sand crabs.
And what did you do?
I crept into the crypt, cribbed a crab, and crept out of the crypt again.
I'm glad you made it.
Me too. I pushed on another 10 miles and bagged the biggest trophy of the whole expedition. I discovered the remains of the great Prince Tut.
No.
Yes.
Where?
He weighed 300 pounds in his sandals and toga.
Oh, say, that's a big mummy.
Oh, you might say he was the daddy of all mummies. There he was, shrouded in his wrappings and covered from head to foot with precious gems, lying inside this weird Egyptian tomb.
Sphinx?
A little. But what can you expect? I mean, what can you expect from a man who's been dead for 3,000 years? Well, I brought Tut-Tut back to this country, and I never let that mummy out of my sight.
Loved him, huh?
Oh, yeah. We finally found happiness and success doing a comedy program on an obscure radio station.
Well, now, wait a minute. Wait a minute, Danny. Don't tell me you were on the air together.
Oh, certainly. We were known as Fibber McGowell and Mommy. We had a great program. There was a stooge named Red Skeleton.
Skeleton.
Yeah, and the announcer was H.V. Corbsonborn. It was a ghost-to-ghost hookup.
Sounds pretty gruesome.
Well, we were broadcasting from Death Valley. As a matter of fact, I'm glad that's all over with now. Tut-Tut was very happy until another station went into competition with us and put on a program called Zombie for a Day.
Know the show well.
Oh, you know it?
Oh, yes.
You've heard it?
Mm-hmm.
That's great. I haven't. We lost all of our listeners, and Tut-Tut couldn't stand the disgrace of the failure, so he ran away.
Oh? Oh, you poor kid. You lost your mummy.
Yeah. I traveled the whole world over in search of Tut-Tut. Egypt, Syria, India. I even went to North Africa on a wild goose chase. All I found was a wild goose. No Tut-Tut. Tired, hungry, and worn, searching, ever seeking, I plodded across Africa, struggling through the elephant's graveyard.
Oh, now, Danny, there isn't really such a thing, is there?
Oh, yes, there is, Don. It's legend. An elephant will travel for thousands of miles, over rugged terrain, through swamps and the thick, heavy underbrush of the jungle to get to the place where he's going to die. And he always dies there. It's the trip that kills him. Believe me, I know.
Well, tell me, did you ever find Tut-Tut?
Yes, Don. I finally came across his hiding place, but I just didn't have the heart to dig him up again.
Well, why not?
Well, I knew he had finally found true happiness because, I saw a large tomb, and a middle-sized tomb, and a little tomblet. And not wishing to cause a tumult over the tomblet, I decided to go away, leaving Tut-Tut in his happy married life. And so, Don, I want to sing a song that's near and dear to my heart. And this shall be my answer to the lady who can't forget Al Jolson. A caterpillar is a thriller to a caterpillar. The flowers and the bees are very chummy. A cricket has a thicket where he serenades a cricket. But a man's best friend is his mummy. A beaver can increase the fever of another beaver. A puppet dreams about a wooden dummy. A gopher always has a gopher that he seems to gopher. But a man's best friend is his mummy. Why, in most of my friendships with others, I know there have been many flaws. Oh, but with Tut-Tut and me, though we weren't brothers, he was just like my own flesh and gauze. Because a white fish is the right fish to delight another white fish. A little piggy loves his little tummy. An ermine will determine to get wolfish with an ermine. La da 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 da. Thank you. But a man's best friend is his mummy. My best friend and I are say not divided. No, say, I'm down deep in my heart. I'm excited. To make every day a mummy's day. A turtle who's a flirtle find excitement with a turtle. A little lamb adores his honey lammy. A sea bass who's a he bass loves a sea bass who's a she bass. La da 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 da. Now I don't intend to offend the mammy down in Alabama, but a man's best friend right to the end is his mummy. Sorry, Jolson, not his mammy.
Never before green, yes, never before green could any shampoo reveal all the natural brilliance of your hair. Never before green could any shampoo leave your hair so lustrous yet so easy to manage. When you dream your hair, you bring out all its sparkling highlights. When you dream your hair, you glamorize all its soft, thrilling texture. When you dream your hair, you remove all luster-dulling film and unsightly dandruff. And more, Dreen's rich whipped cream lather leaves your hair easier to set, easier to curl, easier to arrange. So for lovely, lustrous hair, for all types of hair, Dreen shampoo with hair conditioning action. Never before Dreen could any shampoo leave your hair so lustrous, yet so easy to manage. D-R-E-N-E, Dreen shampoo.
Ladies and gentlemen, during a recent overseas tour, my wife, Rosemary, sent me a little idea for a song that we thought was very nice. And just recently, with the help of Jerry Seeland, we finished it. And tonight, for the first time anywhere, Francis Langford is going to sing it with a special arrangement by Carmen Dragon. The song is Just Before I Sleep. Thanks, Francis.
I say for you.
a pity you don't hear me. Every time I dream, it's you again. Every time it's you.
Blanche Bickerson with Danny Thomas as Brother Amos in The Honeymoon is Over. The Bickersons have retired. Mrs. Bickerson lies rigid but awake in the darkness as poor husband John, victim of an obscure type of insomnia that prevents other people from sleeping, exhibits the telltale symptoms of his dread affliction. Listen.
It may be funny to him, but it's not to me. John, John, cut it out.
Cut it out, Blanche.
I'll lose my mind if you don't stop that giggling. What's the matter with you?
What's the matter, Blanche?
You sound like a tickled schoolgirl. What are you dreaming of?
Tickling schoolgirls.
John.
What? What'd you say, Blanche?
I simply won't stand it another night. Living in this house is becoming unbearable.
Let's move.
John, I swear I'm at my wit's end. How long do you think a person can go without sleep?
I've been doing it for 5 years.
John Bickerson, we've been married for 5 years.
Amazing coincidence. Good night.
Don't you good night me, you big sleeping pill. Why don't you have some consideration for me?
Well, what do you want me to do, Blanche?
When you were sick last year, did I say that? Didn't I sit up all hours of the night nursing you? Didn't I?
Yes, you did.
And what was my reward?
I got sicker.
Sure, you can afford to be sarcastic now. You feel fine.
I want to sleep. It's 2 o'clock, Blanche.
You don't remember how I catered to you every minute. When the doctor said not to let you have anything cold, didn't I give you all the ice water you wanted?
You sure did. Almost killed me.
That's gratitude. Well, I didn't expect anything else from you. You don't love me, do you, John?
Oh, of course I do. Just because I don't say it every 5 minutes doesn't mean that I don't love you.
Tell the truth, John. If anything happened to me, would you marry again?
Never, never again.
Well, you don't have to sound so vehement.
Well, if I said it any softer, you'd say I didn't sound convincing. I don't know, Blanche. I just wish you'd let me sleep.
I keep thinking how nice it was before we were married.
Mm-hmm.
You were so different then. You used to plead with me for a little kiss. Now you don't even think of it. Why?
A mouse in a trap loses his taste for cheese.
Very funny. Oh, you're so funny, John Bickerson.
Well, I'm tired, and I have to get up early tomorrow.
You just won't understand, will you? There are none so blind as those who will not see.
Yeah?
The one time I expected you to break down and offer me comfort, and you fail me.
What?
It's all right. I'll struggle through it alone. It won't be long, and When the time arrives, I don't even want to see you near me.
What are you talking about?
I'll go to the hospital by myself. You can sleep right through it.
Blanche! Blanche, are you...
Hasn't Dr. Marvin told you, John?
Nobody told me. What is it?
I'm going to have my tonsils out.
What do you need to have your tonsils out for? You never have sore throats. Your tonsils never bothered you before. You never even knew you had tonsils.
Dr. Marvin said it would help my disposition.
Have them out, by all means.
I don't think I will, after all.
Okay, don't. Good night.
The only reason I was going to do it is because I thought I'd get a good night's sleep.
Okay, do it.
Why should I suffer through an operation? You're the one who keeps me awake. Why don't you do it?
Do what?
Have your tonsils out.
Okay, I'll have them out next week.
You say it, but you won't do it. Have them out now.
What?
Go on, get up and call Dr. Marvin. Let him pull your tonsils out.
Blanche, are you insane? It's 2:30 in the morning.
The hospital stays open all night. Go on, let him pull your tonsils out.
I haven't got any tonsils. I had them out when I was 9.
Well, you need some new ones by now. Let him put some in.
Oh, this is awful. You're deliberately trying to keep me awake. You know I have to get up early and go to work.
Oh, don't make your job sound so important. You take a day off, nothing will happen.
No, nothing will happen except I lose a day's pay. I need all the money I can get. I've got to make a payment on the car tomorrow.
Where will you get that?
I've got it. There's $84 locked in the desk drawer.
60.
84. I looked yesterday.
You didn't look today. There's only 60.
What happened to the other $24?
Don't look at me, John.
Blanche, there are only two people who have a key to that drawer. You and I, and there's $24 missing.
Well, we'll each put back $12 and say no more about it.
How do you like that? Blanche, what did you do with that $24?
I spent it. I bought some perfume.
Perfume? $24 worth? How could you carry that much?
Don't be silly. It was only a 1/2-ounce bottle, and I got it wholesale. It's the newest thing. Very daring. It's called Perhaps.
Perhaps. For $24, they should give you positively. Well, I can't understand. Can't understand why you throw my money away on junk like that.
It isn't junk, and you like it.
How do you know?
Because it's the same kind Gloria Gooseby uses.
I hate Gloria Gooseby.
Well, you're always sniffing around her.
But don't you start with that woman.
You're the one who started it.
I'd like to spend one night in this bedroom without Gloria Gooseby. Just one night.
She just douses herself with that perfume. That's how she catches all the men, the hussy.
She's not a hussy, and she doesn't need perfume to catch me. I mean, I can't stand the kind of Gloria Gooseby.
But you like the way she smells.
I hate the way she smells. I don't see how Leo can live with him. I wish they both dropped dead. Now, either let me go to sleep or I won't go to work in the morning.
Don't go to work. See if I care. You'd have lost a day's pay anyway if I hadn't torn up that summons.
What summons?
For you to serve on a jury.
Well, you can't tear those things up. If I get a jury notice, I have to report.
Why?
Why? Because that's the law. You can't tear up any court order.
I tore up the traffic citation.
What traffic citation?
The traffic citation they gave me to go to court in front of the jury that you were supposed to serve on, but I tore up the notice.
Oh, Blanche, you'll have us both in jail.
Well, that's where my brother Amos is.
Amos? What has he got to do with this?
Well, I was taking a driving lesson.
Oh, Blanche, no! Not in my new car! It's never been out of the garage!
Well, it's out now. I took a driving lesson and paid the instructor $5 an hour, and...
Who was the instructor? It was Amos, wasn't it? It was. I know it was Amos.
I never even took the wheel. Amos was driving, and we suddenly saw this other car careening toward us at 100 miles an hour.
Yes.
Amos didn't have much time, but by an amazing piece of quick thinking, he managed to meet him head on.
Oh.
The funny thing, nobody got hurt, not even the policeman.
What policeman?
In the other car.
Now look, Blanche.
Amos started to bawl them out about driving in the wrong lane, and they had some silly excuse about a police car having the right of way.
Blanche.
And then Amos got mad and hit one of the cops with a wrench.
Blanche, where is my car?
It's on Hill Street between 5th and 8th.
5th and 8th? That's 3 blocks apart.
That's where the car is. About 3 blocks apart. Or it was. They took some of it away to the police pound.
Some of it? But I don't care. I'm insured. I'm just happy they got that Amos in jail.
They can't do anything to him.
Oh, they can't, huh? That's reckless driving and resisting an officer. They can wrap him up good.
They can't do a thing about his driving, and you know it, John.
Why not?
Because he doesn't have a license.
Oh, Oh, that's different. They'll only add another 5 years. I hope they give him life.
John, why do you despise my poor brother so?
Because I hate him. And don't you dare ask me to help him, Blanche.
Well, the least you can do is help me. I have to go to court, too.
Well, it serves you right.
Go on, testify against me. Get me locked up in jail.
Oh, nobody's going to lock you up in jail.
Let them put me on bread and water. You won't feel so good when I walk that last mile, when they slip my pants leg.
Blanche, stop it! They're not going to do anything to you. Now go to sleep.
Go to sleep, he tells me. My poor brother's in jail. My own husband's going to testify against me. Go to sleep. How can I sleep? I'll never... How can he be so heartless?
Hello. Where's the phone, Blanche?
I've got it. Hello?
Blanche, this is Amy. I'm still in jail.
Wait, Amos. I'll get John. Talk to him, John.
Sure. Hello.
Jocko?
Drop dead.
Oh, listen, you gotta come down and spring me. This is the first call they let me make.
Drop dead.
Don't be sorry, Jocko. I'm in an awful jam. I'm in a tank here with 50 other bums.
Drop dead.
But I got money enough to pay for all the damage. I think I even got enough for the bail bond. Get me out, will you, Jocko?
Drop dead.
I swear I'll pay you. I got plenty of dough. I started the crab game here and won over $400.
Dropped $400. Amos, are you loaded?
No, but the dice were. Hey, come down and spring me, will you, Jocko?
Well, I'm going to think about it, Amos. Right now, I'll leave you with two words.
Yeah, well, what's that?
Drop dead! Now I can sleep.
Please, John, dear, get my brother out of jail.
Well, I'll think about it.
I'll do anything for you, John. Please bail him out.
Pour me a shot of bourbon, Blanche.
Are you sure you wouldn't like a double shot, dear?
Just a single. Thanks. Ah, wonderful stuff.
I promise I'll never wake you up again, darling.
And will you forget all about Gloria Gooseby?
Forever. Just get Amos out of that nasty jail.
Well, we can't do anything about it until morning anyway. In the meantime, I think I'll get a good night's sleep.
Certainly, dear. Are you comfortable?
Perfect. Just perfect.
Snore to me, John.
This is Toby Reed reminding you, never before dream. Yes, never before dream could any shampoo reveal 100% of the natural luster of your hair. Listen next Sunday for another pleasant half hour with Don Ameche, Danny Thomas, Francis Langford, Carmen Dragon, and his orchestra. And now here is Don Ameche wishing you good days, good nights, and good luck until we meet again. Everybody's talking about Dreft, the greatest dishwashing discovery in 2,000 years. Dreft, D-R-E-F-T, Dreft, Procter & Gamble's sudsing miracle. It gets dishes so clean they shine even without wiping. Yes, it makes even glasses sparkle like jewels. Dreft simply can't leave any streaks on dishes the way all soaps do. Why, with Dreft, your nicest glassware positively shines. Dreft is kind to your hands, too. Get Dreft in the bright green package. That's D-R-E-F-T, Dreft. Danny Thomas appeared by arrangement with Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, producers of the human story behind the atom bomb, The Beginning or the End. Danny Thomas' song was written by Jerry Thielen with special music by Carmen Dragon. Ladies, it's more important than ever that you save kitchen fat every day, every mealtime. To help get more soap, fabrics, and other items you want and need, save those fats. The need is urgent, the reason sound. And dealers now pay more per pound. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.
Hi there, this is Bill Bragg, the man with a million friends. And you're listening to The Glowing Dial with my good friends Big John and Steve, right here, right now, on Yesterday USA.
All right, we are back. That was the Bickersons, better known as Dreamtime, from February 23rd, 1947. Hope you enjoyed that. Time for...
I always like a good fight, yeah.
Yeah, right. Well, there's our knockdown and
you could place some bets out on that to see who's going to win this one, you know. That was
I think it's a draw either way.
That was by request.
Yes, it was.
And we'll find out who that's requested by when we get to our mail, right?
Actually, I think it's time for...
I'm gonna sit right down and write myself a letter.
Oh, yes, it is. It's time for the letters here on the Glowing Dial. We've got a little mail to catch up on here, and we're going to do that right now. And Steve has one over there that kind of links in with the first program we played.
It's a holiday card. Wishing us happy holidays, joy and happiness and peace.
Pardon the creaking sound there. I'm going
from,
over to the...
And it's from Walt and Judy Romanowski.
Oh, okay. Wonderful.
And it says,
what
thanks,
do they say?
Thanks for what you do on YUSA.
Thanks for the memories.
Could you please play the Bickersons? Yes, well, you got your wish, because we did.
Yeah, all right. And we've got... I've just moved over here to the computer screen, where actually we have some more letters. John Sinnott, this is a while back, actually, just received the Fibber and Molly tapes. He's the guy that won the contest for the McGee Machine. They are great. I was under the impression that the first episode, along with most of the first few years, no longer existed. Imagine my surprise when it turned up in the set. I can't wait to listen to them. I'm going to relatives for Thanksgiving, and the wife and kids and I will have a ball playing them in the car. And he goes on to ask how I went and store my my tapes and everything, and I went on to answer that question for him. We have another one here by from Chuck and Patricia Jansen. Dear Big John, Steve, you fellows are unbelievable. I just heard your wonderful tape you made at the FOTR convention. What a great show, especially for those of us who were only able to be with you in spirit. Thank you so much for bringing FOTR to all of us. It was super to hear all the YUSA listeners, as well as Bill and the rest of the YUSA family. It was great to actually hear Kim and her grandmother. I've heard so much about them, I now feel I know them too. Because of YUSA, I've become a very close friend of my uncle Ed Bolton. He recently told me that Kim attended one of his taping sessions, since they both live in Harrisburg. This made her appearance on your tape very special to me. As I scroll down here, come on, silly machine. You really blew my mind again when you ended your show with another of those precious Uncle Josh recordings. Yes, it was a little scratchy, and it was wonderful, right down to the last scratch. Bill Bragg said on his show one night that Uncle Josh died in 1919. We were referring to Cal Stewart, who did the bulk of the, if not all, of the Uncle Josh recordings. I am sure he knows, so your statement that all his recordings go back to the teens and earlier has to be correct. I feel that this Uncle Josh was especially for me, and I am truly flattered. Now that I have heard Labor Union, I am sure that this record was also in my grandparents' collection so many years ago. Keep up the great work. I listen to you over and over each two-week period. I just can't get enough of YUSA. It's the most fun place on earth, and you are all wonderful, Chuck and Patricia Jansen, two dear people. And I think they've probably written to us more than anybody else. And here's another one by them, dear Big John and Steve. I just have to tell you what a great idea this DJ bio page is. It was nice to see your pictures included. I enjoyed the article on your... I enjoyed the article on you both. Thank you so much for another Glowing Dial special effort. Keep up the great work. And let me tell you, it's letters like this, folks, that that keep us going here. And this one is from Jeff Lackey. Says, saw your post in the ODR Digest. Have a question for you. Is it possible to become a paying member of YUSA via a credit card? And Jeff, not at this time. Well, we are not set up to accept credit cards. Personal check or money order is fine. And you can mail that to Yesterday USA Radio, 2001, Plymouth Rock, Richardson, Texas, 75081. And that'll get to the right person. Bill Bragg, to be specific. He goes on to say, I didn't see a way to do that on the website. Also, for paying members, do you have any real audio OTR archives that play streaming as opposed to having to download them and then play? I think if you have enough bandwidth, if you have a good enough modem, I believe some of those files you can listen to. And yes, we are over 1,200 titles now. This thing is growing. He goes on to say, I sent a letter to Music Choice petitioning them to play Yesterday USA full-time on its own dedicated channel on DirecTV. They indicated they are fully willing to negotiating with DirecTV. I guess it's time to write DirecTV. Well, the DSS deal has since gone bye-bye, so we won't be doing that anymore. Gary Sheehan just sent a nice little thing saying, Happy Christmas. May the joy of Christmas fill your hearts with its true meaning, the birth of our Savior, the Sheehans. And thank you, Gary, for that. That's nice. Moving on, like I said, we had a lot here. Chuck and Patricia again, dear Big John, Steve, and Uncle Josh.
He's part of our family now, yes. I guess. He lives here, too.
Just a note to wish you a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. I also want to thank you both for your fine effort on YUSA this past year. I have enjoyed all your programs. Keep up the good work. I don't know what Bill Bragg pays you for your time, but I'll bet it's not enough. Chuck and Patricia Jantz.
Would you like to know how much that is?
He just gave us a raise, paying us double now, so double.
Nothing is
still
nothing.
But folks, the letters we are reading right now are the payment, let me tell you. This one's from Kelly Nichols. Dear John and Steve, just note to tell you that I really appreciate all your effort. I enjoy your show very much. I know you donated the book tuning yesterday for the auction, and though I'm glad it commanded such a sum for YUSA, it was out of my league. Was this published in paperback? I will continue to scour Delaware for a copy. Any suggestions? Well, Kelly, just keep scouring the used bookstores, and if you go to conventions, you may find dealers that have it there too, but it's quite expensive, commanding upwards of $100. John Dunning, the author, told me that he's even seen it going for as much as $250. But yes, I do recall seeing it in paperback as well. But John will be releasing an updated version that's like three times the size of this thing. I believe it's called On the Air, the Encyclopedia of Old-Time Radio.
Do we have an update on that? It was supposed to be out this spring.
Well, we're not quite to spring yet. I still see snow out the window, so we're getting there. And
Groundhog will determine that.
Oh, you're, boy.
Groundhog will determine
you have a bad
that,
mic over
there's
going to
be spring or not.
Mic.
That's due not too long from now.
Yes. Last one I think here is Marty Tadnick. Is your radio program broadcast on a station in Southern California, Los Angeles, to be specific? If so, days, times, and frequencies, please. Advance thanks. Not that I know of, unless somebody is taking YUSA and rebroadcasting the signal on one of the low-power AM or FM stations. But the legality of having those, I believe, is in question right now. So, to my knowledge, it is not. But if you have internet access, Marty, you can certainly go to http://otr.uwsp.edu and hear the station via Real Audio. And if you need the Real Audio player, you can download it too from that site. And I think, oh, there's more. Let's hope the tape holds out. This one is Patricia Jansen, I believe. It's actually Dear Steve. Thank you so much for sending me a birthday card. That was a wonderful surprise, and Chuck and I both appreciate your thoughtfulness. I had a very special birthday this year. We were surprised by a very nice visit from friends we haven't seen in over 5 years. They are from Atlanta, and they drove down just to see us on a most beautiful Honda Goldwing motorcycle. They just left this morning for Key West. My folks live on that street. Anyway, Chuck was very jealous of them because he has always wanted to buy a big motorcycle like theirs and tour the country. I'd go for a motorhome myself, actually. But they go on to say it is only a dream for him because his diabetes causes dizzy spells, so he wouldn't dare try it anymore. Dizzy spells and motorcycles don't mix. Yes, we agree with that. We hope you and Big John have a very good year in 98. See you on YUSA. And that's Patricia Jansen. And the last one here is from our good friend Sally Ilko.
Oh,
out in
I haven't
Craig,
heard
Colorado.
From Sally. What does she have to say?
Hi, John and Steve. Just finally got upgraded on my computer big time, and now I can listen to and tune in whenever I want to. I like your biography. Do you feature someone new every 2 weeks? Yes, Sally, we were trying to do that. I don't have a lot of the DJs haven't gotten back to me yet. Are you listening, Dan Riazzi? Anyway, as soon as I get more information, it will change. Tony Fournier is currently on the page right now. Also, I have tuned into the chat room numerous times and have gotten no response. Must the live show be on? Yes, it usually only you'll find people in there just when the live shows are on, especially Sunday night and sometimes on Bill's nightly live shows that he does. Hope you both had a great holiday season. Been kind of busy, so haven't been listening much. Love, Sally Ilko. And, wow, that is a lot of mail. I think we read more mail than Bill Bragg did, usually on his show, on the live show.
Well, yes, we've had lots of changes. I mean, I've had a nose job, and lots of stuff has happened here, so
Looks like the same nose to me.
Well, you can't tell from the outside.
Oh. It's what's inside that counts.
That's right.
What's inside a nose is generally snot. But anyway, let's this is what's that?
No, it's that.
It's chiffon.
That's right, folks. Inside my nose, I have lovely chiffon.
Yes. Anyway,
if you believe that, you know, would you like some swamp land up upstate Michigan here?
Yeah. Or never mind. Before we continue with this insanity, folks, it's time for this listening reminder.
Hi, this is Frank Brzee, Little Beaver on Old Time Radio's Red Rider. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts Big John and Steve, heard exclusively on Yesterday USA Radio.
All righty, that does it pretty much for the letters. Speaking of letters, I told you that our good buddy Fred Foy is going to be along to tell you how you can get in touch with us, so I hope you grabbed a hold of a writing implement and something to write on while we were reading the mail there. Steve,
hopefully something silver.
Why does it have to be silver?
Because wasn't that the name of the color that the Lone Ranger always liked best?
Yeah, and I suppose you would greet it by saying, "Hi-yo, silver." Away, Steve, away. Anyway, I wish we had John Rayburn here to say that spoonerism for us. I can't remember how
the
it
Lone
goes.
Lone Ranger.
The Lone, or the Lone Ranger guides a wren. That's it, yes. And, yeah, we got some celebrity interviews, folks, as well, coming up in, actually, the next installment of The Glowing Dial is going to feature another celebrity interview. I haven't decided who it's going to be yet, so it's a surprise.
You make it sound like it's a payment. It's an installment.
Don't say that to me. I got enough creditors hounding me already, all right? I don't need any, Werewolf. 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 Bill Collector. All right. Anyway. See, we're just bantering a little bit and let you run and get that pen. You probably have it in your hand and you're saying, shut up and give me the address. So we're going to do that.
I've got that in my mouth.
Yeah. Right.
This is Fred Foy, here to tell you how you can get in touch with the Glowing Dial. Big John and Steve want to hear from you. They'd like your comments and suggestions and any requests you may have. You can contact them by any of the following means. Send email to glowdial@ix.netcom.com or by phone by calling 810-774-0112. That's 810-774-0112. Or send snail mail to The Glowing Dial, 29121 Lund, Warren, Michigan, 48093. Write or call now. Big John and Steve are waiting to hear from you.
It's a beautiful day. Spend it right here with Yesterday USA Superstation.
All right, everybody, we are back. Hope you got that address information down. It is time for something very, very special here, and something we have just about enough time to do here on the Glowing Dial this edition. And oddly enough, Chuck and Patricia Jansen seem to be cornering the market here, don't they?
No joshing.
Yeah. Anyway, I have in my hot little hands a case, actually the tape is in the machine, of some more Uncle Josh material that Bill Bragg was nice enough to dub me off a copy. These are from some old Edison cylinders, I believe, and the sound is not too bad. This is, I'm not sure if this is done under just the name Cal Stewart or it's Uncle Josh. I'm not even sure of the title of it, I'm sorry, but it's something about him keeps mentioning I laughed at the wrong time, so it could be the laughing song or something like that. But anyway, here's a little bit of Uncle Josh, and we'll be back to say goodbye.
Come on. me wrong time. I just had to laugh if I didn't, I would burst. Father was a swearing and kicking up the dust. Father said, son, you come along with me. I have a few words I want to say to thee. And I laughed and I went. But I laughed at the wrong time. Mother used to say when I was a laughing, now don't laugh at the wrong time. I couldn't see no reason why I shouldn't laugh. Laughing wasn't any crime. So I laughed when mother licked the stuffing out of brother. She wore out one stick and then she got another. I laughed. But I laughed at the wrong time. I just had to laugh. I couldn't keep it in. I couldn't keep from laughing, so I knew it was a sin. Mother said, son, before you go to bed, come with me out to the woodshed. And I laughed and I went. But I laughed at the wrong time. I tried to remember when I got to laugh and not to laugh at the wrong time. But I couldn't do it, so I knew that I would ruin. Laughing was in my line. So I laughed when Uncle took a tumble in the river. He ran out his clothes and then commenced to shiver. Then I laughed. But I laughed at the wrong time. I just had to laugh, so I knew it wasn't right. I had to laugh, cause Uncle was a sight. Uncle said, boy, now you listen unto me. Bring me a limb from that apple tree. And I laughed as I went. But I laughed at the wrong time. Old, I still keep a laughing and I laugh at the wrong time. Something's always sure for to happen when I laugh at the wrong time. So I laughed when Nancy let her snuffle in the butter. Nancy couldn't swear, she had just a sneeze and stutter. And I laughed. But I laughed at the wrong time. I just had to laugh, but I knew what I would get. I thought that Nancy was going to have a fit. Nancy said, I'll teach you not to laugh at me. She grabbed the broom and commenced to wallop me. And I laughed as she did. But I laughed at the wrong time.
Well, there we have it, an Uncle Josh recording there. I don't know what the title is, the laughing song, or laughed at the wrong time, or whatever. But I hope you enjoyed that, everybody, and especially Chuck and Patricia. And I want to thank you all again for tuning in to another fun-filled episode of The Glowing Doll here on Yesterday USA. And sorry, the mail spot ran a little bit long there, but we have... had a lot of mail to catch up
if
on.
If people give us, you know, letters and stuff,
we
have to
the
read
weather.
Them.
We've been under the weather for
it's
a
only
while,
fair.
Too, some of us. So, for now, this is Big John and Steve saying, keep a positive thought, keep looking up, and we'll see you on the radio. Bye-bye.